You build a website. That's kind of my personal home in the internet. It looks like this on the front page. It lives in amati.org.
It's
my home in the internet. The place where I keep my blog, my projects, my speaking engagements, and anything that I want to after. And one of the key reasons why I have a home, we need to go back like 20 years when I started learning how to code. I've had a website in some form since like 2002. It has changed a lot over the years. It's lived in different places. And the most recent one, I built in the early 2019 when I met Fotis, who introduced me to Eleventy. And I haven't done a major rewrite in 2 years. But in addition to having my own website back in the day, I also built websites for some of the nonprofits that I was involved. They didn't ask for it. They didn't do any specs. But it allowed me to have a sandbox of my own. At that time, I was learning PHP. Now I'm learning serverless and Rust. And during these 20 years that I've been doing some coding, having these homes in the internet where I can do anything I want has been really crucial in testing out new technologies, learning how to do stuff while making something worthwhile. Not having to worry about legacy, not having to worry about deadlines, client demands, or anything like that, but building what I want to build. And when I want to be bleeding edge, I can be bleeding edge. And when I just want to get something done, I can use the trusty old technologies. The second reason why I have a home in the internet is that I love blogging. This Wednesday, I reached a milestone of like 1 year of publishing a blog post every week. And the cool thing about having the blog on my own site is that I'm the ultimate authority on what gets published. If I would publish my blog on, say, Dev2, I would have to post basically developer-related stuff. And people would comment on my board game post that, like, this is not the place for them. But with my own blog, I can control. I can post anything I want. And I can make it in any format I want. I can use any gadgets and widgets, frameworks that I want to use. And I could talk about blogging for hours. But this is not a talk about that. This is a talk about the technical side and the kind of, in a way, DevOps side of my website. So at the very core, there's a program called Eleventy, which is a static site generator built in JavaScript. It's now version 1.0. It's a really cool project. We have a lovely community. And it is the piece that makes builds everything. There's a bunch of different ways to get the data in, bunch of different formats. But what Eleventy does at the core is that it takes the data, it makes HTML so that I can put it online. For the data side, for my blog, I use Ghost as an headless CMS. I started using Ghost when I got a little bit bored on writing Markdown for my blog posts. And then I listened to an Indie Hackers podcast where the founder of Ghost was sharing his story and why he started Ghost. And what really resonated with me is that Ghost is a not-for-profit. So they built the organization like that so that they can focus on the things that they want to focus. So that nobody can essentially buy Ghost from them. So they can focus on building a great platform for publishers. And on the other side of the pipe, I use Netlify for two things. I use it for hosting, because back when I deployed it, you could just drag and drop. You still can. You could just drag and drop the build folder and you had a website. And I loved that. I also use it for the serverless. And I'm going to talk a little bit about what I use it for a little bit later. So this is what my blog post used to look like. I used to write them in Markdown, in VS Code. And I did it because that's how developers write blogs, right? That was what I had heard. And I did that for quite a while. But then at some point I realized that I didn't write as much. I didn't enjoy writing prose in a code editor with like monospace fonts and stuff like that. Not very visual. And I really, really liked at the time the user experience or the writer experience of Medium.
Like it was
while Medium was still a little self-hosted CMS. And I use it because the writing experience is really, really good. The one downside with it is that the customizations are very limited compared to using like WordPress or Contentful. You cannot just add custom fields whenever you want to. So I had to do some hacks, and I use the tags not only for tagging blog posts, but also tagging metadata. And depending on certain tags, I do different things. And for all the other tags, they're just tags. So it's not the perfect solution. But I think the simplicity and the limitations also help me focus. I don't have the luxury of building absolutely anything. So I need to focus on writing and getting stuff done. There's also the link to the podcast. I will share the slides in Slack. Then there's the Elevantil, as I mentioned. It's a wonderful tool. It has a great ecosystem of plugins, examples, tutorials, starter kits. But it's also built in JavaScript, and it's extremely easy to extend. Now, I've never written a plugin to anything. But with Elevantil, I don't need to. I can just make JavaScript files that do stuff. I can add data, like data pipelines, as JavaScripts. And I can do NPM scripts for the other stuff that I'm going to talk about. So the fact that I don't need to make a plugin to extend the functionality to what I need is something I really like in Elevantil. Now, I've used different site builders in the past, Hugo and Jekyll, mostly those two. But ever since I switched to Elevantil, I've just been enjoying the experience. And the community is great. And there's a really great Geek Elevantil meetup that's once a month, where people share all sorts of fun tricks. And for hosting, I use Netlify because it's really easy to use and get started. But it also has a really good developer experience. They have a fantastic command line tool that you can use to host locally, including the serverless side. It can do deployments, previews, anything that I would need. And they have Netlify functions for serverless functionality. And the creator of Elevantil works at Netlify, so they work really well together, especially for the serverless. So this is an example of what I use the serverless for. I have these categories on my blog, and I basically download a metadata kind of file or JSON from the serverless that I then use to showcase the correct elements on the page. Now, do I need serverless and JavaScript for this? Absolutely not. But it's my first time doing serverless. So this is what's great about your own site, is that I don't need it. It's probably not the right tool, but it's a way for me to experiment in a real life use case. It has helped me learn much more about serverless than if I would have come up with some looking at tutorials type of stuff. It also does one little bit too many requests. So it's not optimal. I kind of figured it out a couple of months ago that it's not the best, but I haven't fixed it yet. So then I want to talk a little bit about the kind of workflow that I use to build. Because if you think about Jamstack, which is the hot thing right now, everybody builds things on that. Quite often you have some kind of CI/CD pipeline where you make a post and then you push it to GitHub and it does the build and it deploys. I ain't got any of that. I write a blog post in a browser, then I fetch the new posts with a custom JS script that takes the data from the Ghost Content API into Nunchucks files. Nunchucks is a templating engine. At the same time, I use another script to update the data for the serverless functions. Then I manually build the website with Elevantil command line tools. I serve it localhost with Netlify, and then when I'm happy, I deploy it for preview, and then I deploy to production. Each and every one of these steps is manual, and each and every one of these steps is separate. So when I go to my CMS and I click publish, absolutely nothing happens. When I push to GitHub or Bitbucket, absolutely nothing happens. Why is that? So the first thing that I do is that I have a script that gets the data for new blog posts in JavaScript, and then it writes that as as an HTML with front matter into the non-JAX files that the 11.10 uses. And one of the differences here to what you might have used with Jamstack is that I don't do this at build time. I do this before the build. There's a couple of reasons for that. One is that when I was setting it up, I was a bit lazy, but then I retrofitted some good reasons. One of them is that I'm kind of independent from my CMS. So if my ghost would go down, I can still make a build and I can still deploy that because all the content is in my local repository. I also still use Markdown for some of the blog posts, especially the legacy ones. But it kind of separates me. And it also means that all the content lives in my version control because the build folder doesn't live there. So I download them first. So that also means that if somebody hacks my CMS, they cannot publish anything. They cannot change anything on my website because there's no automation. So I don't build or host anything from the ghost. I download the stuff beforehand, and then I build it, and then I deploy it. And the benefit is that I can change my CMS at any point. I can pick up content for next week if I feel like it. And I just need to make a new script that downloads those posts. Now there's a little asterisk, just like Mikhail had, because, well, I kind of do. I currently host the pictures from my CMS. In January of 2019, no, 2020, I did a talk in Helsinki.js talking about my picture system and how it was broken. Instead of fixing it, I just removed it. It's something I need to fix at some point. I really need a system that downloads the pictures and hosts them with the repository, with the code in Netlify. But I haven't done it yet because I've been focusing on the content side and the blogging. But it's kind of the thing that I want to get rid of. And the next thing that I already mentioned is I don't have any automated builds. I don't have any automated deploys. And I like it for this use case. Sometimes when I'm not on my own computer, I would like to make a change on a blog post, or I would like to write a new one and publish it. But it happens so rarely compared to what I really like, which is full control. I don't accidentally publish stuff. I always check it in localhost. I always check it in preview, and then I manually deploy. I'm a huge fan of doing manual deploys for this kind of content. Now, if I would build a website for somebody else who doesn't like command line and code, who just runs to write a blog, I would definitely make it automated because they should be focusing on the content and not how to build it and how to publish it. But for me, as a geek, and as a kind of my sandbox in the internet, I like to have that full control. Now, I mentioned some things that I have, some things that I like about it, but I also mentioned a bunch of things that's missing, things that would be nice to have. I think about rebuilding stuff every now and then, and sometimes that can be a little bit overwhelming. I think we as a developers, we might have discussions at work about the newest stuff, kind of bus factors and pipelines and everything. But the cool thing with personal projects is that that's life. Like, you don't have to always be perfect. You don't have to have all the things that would be really nice in kind of production work environment. I don't mean that I want to do manual deployments on client projects or kind of web apps ever. I want that to be automated, kind of one, at least one click things. But when I work on my own page, it doesn't matter. I can take the time to do these things manually. I can take the time to wait till the next day if I'm not accessing a computer that can do that. And this is something that why I wanted to share this kind of realistic and messy environment that's a little bit broken. Because in meetups, conferences, blog posts, we always talk about the best case scenarios, the best practices, and all the new stuff and how to do things perfectly. And it can sometimes be a little bit stressful. So I wanted to tell you that it doesn't have to be. And that's one of the cool things about hobby projects, is that if things get stressful, you can just stop and do something. you can also, in the future, build fun stuff without having to worry about being bleeding edge or being perfect. Thank you.